Let's play Hardball!
I'm Boyet Sison.
I'm Boom Gonzales. Sabaya! Thank you to DJ for sitting in for you and Bill last week.
DJ, thank you very much for sitting in for me. It's been quite a tough week.
Tough week.
Show goes on, baby.
Yes.
The show goes on. Okay, let's begin tonight's first five as we start with Jason Collins coming out of the closet. The 12-year NBA veteran who just entered a free agency got a lot of support from, take this, the White House. And to NBA superstars Kobe Bryant and as well as Dwayne Wade. But the acid test might be in the offseason, and Collins will wait to see which team wants to sign the first openly gay professional active athlete in the U.S.
And that's exactly what I was talking about with a friend earlier today. Everybody coming out in full support and all that. But really, he's a free agent.
Yes.
He's 34 years old. He's a free agent.
No spring chicken. Yeah. He's been quite around. Yeah.
Like seven NBA teams. Mm-hmm. It would be interesting to see what the response is in terms of if anybody's going to sign him.
Well,
for whatever reason.
Yeah. Well, one of the reasons which actually hit me at first will be, will they sign him specifically for what they can still deliver to the team?
Yeah.
Or will it be a PR thing that the teams will be?
Or will anybody sign him at all?
Will anybody sign him at all?
I mean, it's one thing to support it.
Yeah.
And that's easy. I'm not saying that everybody who came out and said that they supported it was insincere. No, not at all. Yeah. Of course they are.
They are.
I'm just
they
saying are. That. It's one thing, you know, to support the statement. It's another thing to actually, you know, sign him and say, you know, we're signing you for your skills. And the funny thing about Jason Collins' career, he was a bruiser.
Yeah.
He wants to
mix it up.
He has given a lot of flagrant fouls. Mm-hmm. He has put somebody on a stretcher.
You know, just to put a bit of humor into this, you know, a lot of people have been saying that. Imagine him in a gay situation now, in a game situation now, wherein certain people on the sidelines will start heckling him. And
for sure,
he will heckle back.
And maybe even some players. You cannot discount the fact that there may be some players who are homophobic.
Yes, yes.
You know, remember the Karl Malone, Magic Johnson thing back in the day when Magic had AIDS. You know, all of those things.
But that'll be interesting.
We'll see. He wants to play still. The last team he played for was the Wizards. Mm-hmm. So let's see if anybody signs Jason Collins. His twin didn't even know.
Well, you know, that's another story, the twin.
Yeah.
You know, the twin now has to more or less change his looks because he might be
But he didn't
mistaken.
Know, right? That's what he was saying.
He didn't know.
All right. Okay, in mixed martial arts, UFC 159 ended in spectacular fashion. To some people, it was the usual fashion. With John Jones successfully defending his title for a fifth straight fight, he ties Tito Ortiz in that category of title defenses. This one on a first-round knockout of Chael Sonnen.
No, frankly, I wasn't... Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just about to say that had he survived the onslaught, Sonnen would have actually seized Jones' light heavyweight belt after the champion suffered a gnarly toe injury. And
I wasn't able to watch it.
Well,
explain to me the gnarly toe injury.
Okay, first of all, the toe injury... Well, the fight was already over.
Mm-hmm.
He put on his shirt, they put on the belt, they announced his name... excuse me, put up his hand, Joe Rogan comes in to interview, that's when he notices his nose broken. His toe is broken. And they showed it on screen how he broke it, and it is nasty. It is not...
And he continued on with his...
Well, at that time, that's his adrenaline. He didn't even notice that his toe was broken. And after this, when he was announced already as the winner, and Joe Rogan comes to him, that's when he notices it. See, he's still walking straight. And then that's when he sat down and he realized he couldn't walk anymore.
God.
Anyway, going to the fight, what he did here, what he tried to prove here, he did some sort of like a GSP thing. Chael Sonnen's weapon, obviously, of choice was going to be wrestling, just like what he did with Anderson Silva. He out-wrestled him and, you know, ground and pound and eventually had the technical knockout. GSP would do the same thing. People would criticize his striking. He'll outstrike Josh Koscheck. He's not a natural wrestler.
He'll out-wrestle the
two-time champion. You know, so that's what I think what he wanted to prove John Jones. It was a spectacular card with Roy Jones in it, Michael Bisping, Alan Belcher, but John Jones just proved again he was superior, the smaller Chael Sonnen, and so he's still the champion. He's going for a sixth defense soon enough. After the injury, I would assume probably November, December. He won't be able to fight anytime soon.
But I would love to see a John Jones.
Anderson Silva?
And Anderson Silva.
Yeah, well, everybody wants
even,
to see
or
that.
Maybe even a GSP. But I
don't know. The GSP thing is not going to happen.
That won't happen.
It's not even more possible GSP Anderson, but not GSP John Jones. Right. Not going to happen.
Okay, Manny Pacquiao will return to the ring this November in Macau.
Speaking of not going to happen.
Not going to happen.
There are things that didn't happen.
But it won't be for revenge against Juan Manuel Marquez or Timothy Bradley. I was saying it, but I don't know what the last two fighters to beat the Pac-Man have chosen to fight each other in September.
So the announced fight is Brandon Rios, am I right?
Brandon Rios.
There was a choice between Alvarado and
Alvarado
Rios.
Rios. And Rios looks to be the opponent.
Yeah, as of this morning.
As of this morning. But for all of us fight fans, obviously, we all want revenge. We all want revenge. And for them to be fighting each other, the two fighters that have beaten Pacquiao.
Pang-asar
talaga eh. Now, whoever wins here, for me, should be challenged by Pacquiao.
Challenged
by Pacquiao. He should challenge that.
Okay. But Pacquiao has to go through somebody else first.
Yes. Well, for me...
And they're saying Rios is the perfect opponent. He's a forward-moving opponent. Mm-hmm. You know, something that Manny likes. Mm-hmm. And also to get back into the... You know, the group before he faces either Marquez or the Bradley fight, which everybody knows.
So, but see, that eliminates one of the two, because it's either you fight Bradley or Marquez. And then before, possibly, Mayweather?
Who, by the way, will fight this weekend, right?
Who will fight this weekend.
That should be good.
That's Guerrero,
They dangled money on both Marquez and Bradley, and they said no, right? They said no.
Why will we fight him? We've already beaten him. That's a statement. But, as you know in boxing, it's turned over till it's really over.
And swing to the NBA, may tapos na.
Yeah.
With the season already over for the disappointing and hard luck LA Lakers, the front office is now setting its sights on rebuilding for next season, while also keeping their keepers, aka Dwight Howard. While there are some fans who think the Lakers are better off without the All-Star center, Lakers GM Mitch Kupchak hopes Howard will return for next season and beyond. I'd be also interested to see what they're going to do to Mike D'Antoni before the whole Howard thing. Well, not before the whole Howard thing, but obviously Howard's the one they want to keep. The Lakers have the most money to offer Howard.
Right.
They're dangling a 5-year, $118 million contract. That's $20 million more than any other team that can offer. That includes Dallas, Cleveland, Houston. So... But we don't know how Dwight Howard thinks.
You know, for me...
He flip-flops.
The past two coaches have delivered to the Lakers a playoff spot. They were able to get into the playoffs.
No. I disagree. Well, Mike D'Antoni did not deliver a playoff. Kobe Bryant delivered the playoff spot.
But
I know what you're saying.
Mike Brown was able to bring them to the playoffs. yes. Mike D'Antoni was able to bring them to the playoffs. But I agree with you as well. You know, a lot of the newer members of the cast have also contributed a lot. But here's the
proof that he was worth the money.
Exactly.
Well, let's say he's injured and all that. But in his history, even with Orlando, I'll play, I won't. I'll play, I won't. It's nothing new that we see Dwight Howard indecisive.
For me, it's very bad for your teammates to keep on wondering, will he be here next year or won't he?
Because
it plays into the whole...
That's what happened to Orlando.
Right. It plays into the whole chemistry thing, to the bonding with your co-teammates, even with the fans themselves. So now, with Howard dangling that in front of the entire Lakers fan base, as well as the organization, puts a lot of pressure on, again, Mitch Kupchak, the ownership and all that, the entire team.
Well, if it's money, he should stay. If it's winning tradition, he should stay. If he has enough pride to try to salvage what happened this year and try to recover, and maybe from a PR standpoint, he should stay and try to work it out and bring the team to greater heights. If he's that kind of a guy, that is my question. Is he that kind of a guy? Or is he the kind of guy now who wants the easy, not easy way out, but the easy way to... of finals. And this was that lineup, as we all know. Not the lineup. The starting five.
That was hands down a guaranteed conference championship already.
Well, that's what people were saying. Yeah. But then again, it's Mike D'Antoni coaching. Yeah.
Okay, and finally, Michael Jordan tied the knot over the weekend, marrying his girlfriend of 5 years. Oh, what a guy. Model Ivette Prieto in a
podcast. I love the comment. What a guy.
Fitting MJ status as a basketball legend. We on Hardball wish 50-year-old MJ and his 35-year-old new wife good luck. But just in case it doesn't work out, and Prieto is in line for a huge payout.
Wow, I like how forward.
MJ and his first wife Juanita divorced in 2006. Juanita ended up receiving $168 million. The $64 question is there a prenuptial agreement?
How dare us think about the end right away?
okay, and think about 35 years old.
The money.
Oh, baby.
Hey, you know, I read a book that they're saying that Yvette has had a major effect on MJ in terms of his persona. Mm-hmm. He's a little more mellow now. Or maybe that's just him being 50. The wedding tent
Thank
that
you,
they
boo.
Used.
Okay, go.
Sorry,
go ahead,
I did not mean that about you.
I did say,
unless you have
MJ's
money.
No, come on.
the tent that they used for the wedding was bigger than his own
house. Oh, yeah, exactly.
It was like a
record. He has that much moolah.
Well, we all know that.
We all know that. But, you know, 2,000 plus visitors?
The point I'm trying to make, though, is maybe...
He really loves to.
Well,
Or, and vice versa.
How could you not?
Oh, yeah, hey, yeah.
She is hot.
Yeah, sure.
From a man's standpoint, she is hot.
Oh, yes. If you leave it at that, she's hot.
On last week's Hot Ticket, we tried to predict which teams would sweep their first-round NBA playoff series. Guest host TJ Manotok said the Heat and the Thunder. I went with the Heat, while Bill texted his vote. The Clippers, ooh, that's painful. Turns out only the Spurs and the Heat swept their opening-round opponents. TJ and I got one right, since TJ is not really part of the show. No disrespect, partner. I'll see you in the NBA Finals. My vote is the only one that counts here. Now, for this week's Hot Ticket, perhaps the toughest NBA first-round playoff series is the battle between the Clippers and the Memphis Grizzlies.
True.
The Grizzlies currently lead that best-of-seven affair 3-2. Which of those two teams will advance? I answered this. I know it's a question tonight, but I'll answer this the way I predicted at the start of the season.
Mm-hmm.
To me, until Vinny Del Negro's coaching the Clippers, they're not going to make it to where they want.
Mm.
He's been bailed out by CP3 the last 2 years in many, many games.
It still is being
the last game.
Especially
they had an 8-point lead, lost it in the last 4 minutes, and who bailed him out? CP3 again. Today, if it weren't for CP3, that game wouldn't even be close. The one against Memphis today.
Now it's 35 points.
I'm going with Memphis even before the start of the series, even if they were down 0-2. So I'm sticking to my guns.
You know,
I have no choice because it was recorded.
You know, I will agree with you on this because with the recent spate of misfortune, especially in today's game.
The Blake Griffin injury?
With the high
ankle injury?
Yeah, with Blake Griffin not being 100%. Blake Griffin, a very important cog.
But he has been a non-factor, though.
Yeah, but see, all the more. All the more that Memphis is now getting a really good feel about getting into probably a conference final once again in the West.
And the guys who are killing the Clippers, mm-hmm. other than, is really the two big guys.
Right,
especially, Gasol and Zeebo.
Well, aside from that, the Twin Towers of Memphis, you mentioned Gasol and Zach Randolph, I think their defense is really
locked down. For sure.
That defense is really working wonders for them.
Which has never been Vinny Del Negro's expertise. Mm-hmm. Defense, mm-hmm. rebounding has been the problem in their losses.
Yeah, right.
And strategically, it seems like he just doesn't have answers in the end, unless CP3 takes over.
Unless
pick and roll,
their offense really starts kicking in, and they got the momentum out of that. But defensively, they're lost.
I just don't think he's the guy who will take them to that level. And if they get booted out, that's two LA teams that are out in the first round. Mm-hmm. And for Vinny, you make it past the first round last year, and then you don't get past the first round this year against the same opponent. So, you know, with that kind of talent. Oh. Remember, they also don't have a lock on CP3, if ever.
Right.
He might also lose it. So, Vinny.
That might
move. That's my boy, Mike D'Antoni and Vinny.
Okay, up ahead, our favorite rugby team returns.
Welcome back
to their favorite sports show, Hardball. Stay with us.
This coming elections, McCafe reminds you to vote wisely.
Of the Asian Five Nations tournament, the Volcanoes suffered a bad loss to perennial champions Japan, but are looking to bounce back. Oh, and they will.
Good
they
editing.
Take, host Hong Kong on Saturday at the Rizal Memorial Stadium. After Hong Kong, the Volcanoes will face South Korea, then back home against the United Arab Emirates. In the studio to talk about the Asian Five Nations Tournament are the Volcanoes, led by their coach right here, Jared Hodges, and players Austin Dacanay right there, James Karandang Price, and Michael Estrada
Juhig.
Just to prove to everyone that they have Filipino blood. Right. Welcome, gentlemen.
First
welcome.
Question, was it, especially for those who are still trying to learn the sport, was it as bad as the score suggested?
Right.
The match?
No.
Okay.
No. Now, obviously, Japan's 13th in the world. They've been number one in Asia for a long time.
And they haven't lost in that.
No. They've got a fully-fledged professional competition.
Correct.
Professional coaches, so that experience helped them. And for the first 30 minutes, we really held our own against Japan. It was our first effort in the top league, so there's going to be a little learning for us to adjust to the speed, the physicality, and the pressure of the game.
You know, not to dwell too much on this loss, but for me, what I want to ask is, give me more particulars as to what did we really learn with this match with Japan?
Oh, we learned that we need to play a lot faster.
Faster meaning you have to pace, you have to control the pace of the game and dictate more than anything.
Well, the pace of the game, and also we've got to execute our skills under a bit more pressure, and that pressure comes with speed and time.
Austin, was size a factor?
Yeah, they were big.
Sumo wrestlers. Somebody was telling me, everywhere. I thought the Filipinos were big, but...
Yeah, they were big.
Yeah.
From
forward? Right?
Everywhere.
Everywhere, okay.
But, it was... They were a very, very strong technical team, too.
I wanted to ask, were we talking about size versus tactical? What are we talking here?
Yeah, I think they're a team that we played that was the most comprehensive. I mean, they had all the skill, but they also had the size and fitness that we could not match. Mm. But again, you know, this is our first effort here, and just riding a bike, you have to fall a few times before you get it right.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we knew that it was going to be a tough task, and I think we answered as best we could for this particular setting. So,
James, you know, you're one of the quicker guys of the team. I know that.
Apparently, yes.
Okay, well, you're one of the quicker guys, but how quick is quick? As far as the Japan team is concerned,
not quick enough. I think for us, I think seeing the Japanese players, they obviously in a professional setting, a lot of them play professionally in their own teams and their club teams and whatnot. And I think they're just a well-drilled side. I think that we, as a team, we handled it obviously for the first 30 minutes, which is great. But I think we're just slightly off the mark. But I think it's a learning curve for us.
But we also have some players who have experience in Japan, correct?
Definitely.
Did it matter? Did it not matter?
No. It definitely came and helped us a lot. Mm-hmm. Like I think there's close to nine players that are playing over there, and we've experienced that culture and their coaching and whatnot, and it gave us a bit of an insight into how they play their game, which we utilised in that first 30 minutes. Mm. I think it's just as being a very well-drilled team, they could execute 30 minutes and plus, and
correct.
I think we just got to that point and just ran out of resources for us.
Was the playing conditions more familiar to them than it was to you? Did it make a difference?
Definitely.
Yeah, coming from...
Definitely.
Yeah. Oh, really? In what way? What are we talking about here?
It was freezing.
It was
raining, and my pants were wet the whole game. And my feet.
You wet your pants the whole time? Okay. No, just joking.
Okay, Michael, let's look forward now.
Yes.
Hong Kong, I bet you can't wait to get back on the field.
That's correct.
Our hometown against Hong Kong. What are we looking at? What are our prospects? What are we facing against Hong Kong?
As far as the forwards go, they're going to be very similar, very big, very aggressive as well. Their backs, in my opinion, the Japanese backs are a little bit better, but that's not to say Hong Kong won't be very classy as well. But at the same time, we've really got to knuckle down, myself and Austin, who play forwards, really got to show some aggression up front and sort of lay that platform for the other playmakers like James, Mike Letts, those sorts of people to execute in the back line. And if we can do that well, that's all we can really hope for. Yeah.
Well, it's got to be a warm day to play rugby when they
tell us the forecast here, me for Boyet.
It's gonna be fair.
Really?
I don't know what time is the game.
7 p.m.
Oh, that'll be around 34 degrees centigrade.
Humid. That's just the way you are.
Have you been practicing in that particular in those particular conditions right here in Manila? Have you, Jared?
Yeah, we've been working hard. It's, I don't think it's got below 34 for the for the past 2 weeks that we've been here. So no, the heat won't bother us at all.
I love that we have a weatherman to tell us specifically. You cannot contest the information here, Coach. What is the goal here with what we're trying to achieve, other than obviously, you know, promote rugby, get to the next level? We are in the elite class right now. We don't want to go lower than that, right? Because once we get to the next division lower, that's going to be tougher, right? I think, if correct me if I'm wrong, we cannot lose four games here in this.
How many games are we allowed to more or less put behind us?
Our audience,
No, you're going to need to win at least one game.
Okay.
To stay into the top top flight, obviously.
Okay, which is the elite division?
To stay in the top league, yeah. Okay. And then in 2014, those matches next year will be genuine World Cup qualifiers. So the top team next year will qualify directly into the World Cup for 2015. And the team who comes second will have a qualifying game with
another one,
someone else in Europe, a home and away.
Correct. Series. So that means if we do not win a game, which is not going to happen, by the way, if we do not win a game, that will take us off the elite status? Just to clarify?
We'll drop back down to Division 1.
Yeah, Division 1, there.
Which we hosted last
year. Correct.
And obviously won that to earn promotion.
That's why we were up here at elite.
Correct.
Well, you know, the one thing that we are all looking forward to is for you guys to play as hard as you always do on our home turf. And what are you looking forward to as far as this game is concerned?
Yeah, and also, just to piggyback on that, when we talk about Hong Kong, Korea, and UAE, let's look forward to those matches with prospects.
We sat down at the start of our campaign and we've really targeted our home game. So this week, obviously, Hong Kong.
Home game is that one in UAE, correct?
In UAE.
Yeah.
So we've targeted them as wins.
As must wins.
And obviously, after experiencing Japan, we've had to go back to the drawing board. And we've worked hard. We've changed a few things.